we find that our next resource person is already there in the meeting. Sir, with your permission, can we just give 2 minutes break to our participants?
It's okay. I don't think I need. It's okay, sir. I can start. Let them judge. Let them judge. Right. Okay. Let's save 2-3 minutes. Right.
Okay.
Can I start? Just give me a minute.
Sir, let me introduce it.
Okay, fine.
So this is our second session today. This is the last day. And we are having with us very renowned resource person, Professor Sanjeev K. Sharma. He is professor in University Institute of Applied Management Sciences, Punjab University, Chandigarh. He is gold medalist in MBA management from Banaras Hindu University and silver medalist in MSc from Punjab University, Chandigarh. He did FDPM management from IIM Ahmedabad, PhD management and LLB from Punjab University, Chandigarh. His contribution at institutional level include executive member, Punjab University Alumni Association, Vice President, Punjab University Staff Club, chaired more than 25 sessions in conferences, handled 7 major research projects sponsored by UGC, AICT, ICSSR, and industry, and has guided more than 45 PhD researchers and 5 postdoc fellows, as well as member of postgraduate board of studies of 3 universities. He offered training and consultancy to many reputed organizations, published 3 books and 70 plus research papers in peer-reviewed international journals. In case of his academic responsibilities performed by him, include academic coordinator of University Institute of Applied Management Studies, coordinator MBA Biotechnology from 2007 to 11, joint coordinator of MBA program at Punjab University Regional Center, Ludhiana, organizing secretary student research convention, member of expert committee to inspect management institutes by AICT and so on. Professor has held various prestigious positions, include founder coordinator and later director, University Institute of Applied Management Sciences, Punjab University, Dean, Faculty of Business Management and Commerce, Maharaja Ranjit Singh, Punjab Technical University, Bathinda, and many more. So list is very large, and we are having a very expert in our field today for discussion on our the available research products, or how to go for the research products and available funds that are available from different government projects and agencies that can be used for research projects for our young researchers. So the platform is for you, sir. Welcome in our department. Welcome in the FDP on AICT Research Pathology Program.
Right. Doctor, is my screen visible?
Sir, your video is visible. Can you share your screen?
Now it's okay?
Yeah, now it's coming. Yeah, came, sir.
Okay, fine. Thank you, Dr. Deep Jyoti, for inviting me. Let me also share with my parts. Is the audio okay?
Audio is clear, sir.
Okay, wonderful. I know my task is very difficult because I am the last speaker. Typically, the last man is always nobody has any expectations from the last player in cricket. And more so when you are a substitute, right? I am substituting for Professor Chandel, who was supposed to take this session, because of some family emergency, he had to literally ask me to take this session. So I'm thankful to Dr. Deep Jyoti and his team, Madam Nilanjana and others, for giving me an opportunity to interact. Friends, since it's the last session, and I understand my limitations also, that after such an absorbing and interactive session by Dr. Hemendra, I will like to take you away from research, but still make you remain within research. So what I have tried to put together is, what are the emerging challenges and possible responses of a researcher? I understand all of you are so young that most of you have maybe recently PhD or maybe pursuing PhD, and Dr. Deep Jyoti even mentioned that there are some research scholars also. So what I will do is, I will start from the very beginning on how can you make research very exciting. And I will like to break my presentation into small parts, right? Whichever part appeals to you more, I will request you please advise me, should I continue with it, or I will switch over to because typically this topic which has been given to me is so vast that it will be very difficult to do justice within 2 hours. But I will be very thankful to you if there is an interaction, because more the divergent views, better it is for all of us. So when I'm trying to scout for research opportunities, what am I doing? I'm trying to find out what is happening around us. And I presume that most of you are in the domain of management or in social sciences. So I will focus more on social sciences. But in case somebody is from some other domain, I will be very happy if I can learn the lessons from him or her. Okay, so what is the arena within which we are conducting research? We are conducting the research in a highly volatile and uncertain environment, right? Last 18 months have been extremely bad, terrible, right? But still, you will find that there has been almost 3.25 times increase in number of papers submitted for publications in ABDC journals. That means people are using this opportunity of the lockdown to put words to their thoughts. So, and one thing which this pandemic has taught us is that nothing is impossible. And we now start using technology as a great enabler. And how can research be behind, right? So that is the opening comments we will have. And then we will like to talk for around five minutes on the new education policy and how whole of the new education policy focuses on education, on research as a key differentiator. Making an organization, dividing the cluster of organizations into sub-clusters. Okay. Then I will also like to focus on the emerging dimensions of research. Those silos, those watertight compartments are bound to give way to interconnected, interdependent, and interdisciplinary research. So that will be my third focus. I will also like to outline on how can my research be more in tune with the requirements. So do we need to do research for the sake of research, or do we need to do the research so that we improve the quality of life for the mankind or for the society at large? Okay, so recalibrating research will also be one of the focus of my presentation. Then directed by Dr. Deep Jyoti, I will devote substantial time on what are the various funding opportunities available for researchers. Yes, please unmute and you, I think the organizers must have given you that right. You can unmute and ask me the question, because looking at the chat box is a little difficult. So if you can unmute and ask questions, that will be ideal. Okay, so what are the various opportunities where I can find funds for my research? So starting from the nationalized bodies like UGC, AICT, ICSSR, to those which are multilateral funded agencies like UNDP or World Bank or like that, right? And then if time permits and if there is some question or some interaction, we can even discuss what are the ethical aspects of research, especially with regard to funding and plagiarism. And then last, I will like to give you some examples of how organizations, especially in the domain of research and teaching and research, classically universities, they have outshone others in terms of research. So this, if you all approve on this, this will be a broad parameter of my presentation. But I'm, as I said, I'm open to whatever is your area. Okay, so when I'm conducting research in an environment which I said is VUCA, what do we mean by VUCA? Those of us who are in the area of international business or international marketing will understand that this environment is very volatile. It is so uncertain that I can't predict. So you have, on one side, you have technology, which is leading to an integration. Who would have thought 10 years back, 15 years back, that a simple mobile will literally make companies like fax machines, companies like which are into the business of pagers, type writers, sprinters, all of them become extinct in less than 5 years' time. So it's a very, very complex word. And since whatever, as I mentioned, almost three times the number of papers which were received in ABDC in last 6 months over the previous preceding period. So that also shows that people are very are trying to put words to their thoughts and try to use this opportunity to grow. So this term basically originated in the United States. So when after the Cambodia, they felt that we must have a code word, and you know what is happening in Afghanistan is only a replica of what happened there. So now this term is fairly well used in research. So if you understand the nuances of higher education, you will find that things which we did not even dream 5 years back, those of us who are in the wrong side of 40, right, had never heard of something like a virtual classroom, had never heard of platforms like Zoom or WebEx and like that, or Google Meet. But all of us now are fairly well comfortable in these things. So given a choice, we may not have changed. But that VUCA word forced us to change. And now this change is for the better, right? So things like distance learning, corporate classrooms. So 20 years back, 1991, about 30 years back, 1991, we never realized that there will be private universities which will be bigger than even the public sector institutions. Just look at the student base of universities like MIT, right? Just look at the budgets of universities like Palash or Ashoka. Unbelievable, unbelievable. So that means there is now increased competition among institutions of higher education for 3.5 or 4% of our GDP, which is spent on education. And let me build my hypothesis. Research invariably is the first casualty. Organizations have to manage their funds for paying salaries, for their teaching and non-teaching staff, for bare minimum maintenance, for expansion. So where is the money left for research? So that means as a researcher, as a faculty, I am made to fend for myself. Government has come out with wonderful schemes like Atal Tinkering and even this Atal scheme of training and development. And then there is Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya scheme, right? Wonderful initiatives in last 5-6 years. So if these are the paradigm shifts, how does my new education policy, which focuses on research? And if you look at the broad parameters of the new education policy, equal emphasis on teaching, research, employability, and internationalization. So government is very keen that research should also get equal emphasis. Look at the data provided by the NITI Aayog. It is predicted that exclusive 1% of our GDP, we will devote to around 300 institutions of higher learning, which will be research universities. So you are trying to create cream of the cream, best institutions in research, which can compete with global levels and which can be, Prime Minister Modi's dream is to bring at least 5 universities among the top 200 by 2025 in the Times Higher Education ranking or in the QS global ranking, whichever are they, right? So that is the focus. And with that in mind, government is putting a lot of emphasis on research. So top 150 to 300 institutions will be dedicated to research. And then that does not mean other institutions will not. Other institutions to the tune of around 2/3 will be teaching predominantly, but having a large component of research also. So teaching and research, a mix of the two. And then there will be around 10,000 autonomous colleges, which will be made to realize that, yes, teaching is my prerogative, teaching is my main focus, and I will try to develop my own sustainable business models. So this is but why there was a need like this? Where was the need to compartmentalize institutions? Need was because of this, finding of the economic survey. Look at it. We spend only 0.7% of our GDP on research. Our researchers for a population of 1 lakh are absolutely low. Just 15 for every 1 lakh population. I'm not asking you to compare yourself with Israel, right? Which is a technology hub. But even our next door, our major competitor in 2030 will be China. It is almost 9 times ours. And just look at, so if you have lesser researchers, it is going to get affected and will get reflected in terms of your patents. Look at the patent applications 1 year, just 45,000. Even if 1% of them get mature, it is only 450. You understand? So there was no other thing except to focus on research. And Prime Minister Modi was gracious enough to declare, even in his one year of the NEP, he declared that research is going to be the harbinger of growth of India. So just look at other side. We have created an autonomous research institution by the name of National Research Foundation. Anybody need not be in an educational institution who can apply for funding for this. So that means it is not the institution, it is not the affiliation, it is not the researcher, but it is the idea. Because you cannot stop an idea whose time has come. Mind is like a parachute. It works only when it is open. So we need to focus on research. And how can we focus on research? There is now a dedicated agency by the name of NRF, which will focus, which will give you grants. So I will like to take you away from academics into business. Look at Toyota. It allows its competitors to visit its plant. And just compare it with our research institutions. Many of our research institutions may not permit researcher from some other institution to visit their labs. Why? Somebody will copy my idea. And look at one of the greatest automobile producers. They say, let somebody else come, visit my plant. Two things will happen. It will criticize me, so I will improve. It will borrow my idea and take it to their plant. Whole of the industry will improve. If whole of the industry will improve, what will happen? Customers will have more faith on the automobile industry. Healthy competition will lead to expansion of the markets. Same concept, different orientations, different reactions. We all have, those of us who are in management, we all worship Jack Welch, how he transformed General Electric into one of the greatest organizations, from a dead and decaying organization into something which we all admire. And that, I feel, is the role of the head of the department or the research supervisor or the team leader of research group, in case we work in, especially in sciences, we all work in groups, in teams. The role is to harness the talent. Find out who is good at what. Because at the end of the day, the strength of our rope is on the dependent on the strength of its weakest link. So you have to create that aura, that feeling. This is the model I have borrowed from Michael Porter's generic strategies model. If you look at it from research perspective, you have foreign institutions. Many of them are already there, and with this new education policy, many of them will open up, will come to us. Students industry has their own requirements, which research agencies normally feel, no, my role is that of a researcher and not that to satisfy industry. But how can you live in isolation, right? And then there are virtual classrooms and pressure from the government and the teachers to deliver, right? So my first recommendation to all of us is, let us analyze the external environment within which we function and try to find out, can I collaborate? This collaboration may be within the institution, within the department, between departments, within the region. I'll give you examples of how collaborations within the region can lead to success. Many of you may have heard a term, CRIC. I don't know whether somebody has, let me see if where is the chat. If you get time, just Google this word, CRIC. Chandigarh Region Innovation and Knowledge Cluster. 29 top institutions in this region of Chandigarh joined together and are now sharing their resources. If some organization has NMR, some other has MALDI, some other has UV spectrophotometer, they all share. They give discounts to each other. Right? Similar model is being replicated in Hyderabad. Most of these institutions are within a radius of 10 to 12 kilometers, 15 kilometers. Right? Can't we share the resources? If we can share the resources across other institutions, should we not share the resources within our institution? So that is a model you all need to ponder upon, right? So when you look at the dimensions of research, emerging areas, right? You will find that distance, since it is not important, I need to share my findings as soon as possible. Because somebody else may submit a similar paper, and when you submit, the authors may say, the publishers and the editors may say, no, similar paper is already published. So what is novel in it? So you need to come out with your findings and spread those findings as soon as possible. Right? Why? Because dissemination of information now has to be at the speed of light, right? Many of the journals come out with their pre-publication printouts also, right? Another thing which has happened is that many of the top institutions around the world have started their own research agencies. In India, take the case of Reliance, they have a Mudra, they have ORG Marg, right? Like this. Tata's have their own research. Shriram Group has its own labs, SRL. So most of these institutions now do tailored research as per their requirements. And there is an opportunity for us who are in classical institutions. We can join them as a collaborator. And they'll be very keen on, if I have got some USP, some strength, they'll be very keen on joining us, right? Another reason why research has to be an ongoing activity is that all these skills are very specialized. and they are very disloyal. If you don't use those skills today, somebody else will do it. And you will be out. So they have certain amount of urgency. Do you understand? And all these skills are invariably through experience. If you guide one or two PhD researchers, you understand the nuances of how to guide a PhD. Right? So, and skills are also generational. Each generation requires different skill sets. Another thing I would like to bring it to your kind attention is the paradox of our time. There are growing inequalities in the system. Top 10 institutions in the NIRF ranking and those institutions which are only 30, 40 notches down, say 1 to 10 and 51 to 60, you will see marked difference in the scores. Marked difference. Almost 3/4. Same applies in various colleges within the same institution. So, somewhere down the line, this knowledge divide gets aggravated as we move along the chain of, as we move along the value chain. And we as researchers, we as teachers need to think and do something about it. Because societal transformation at one point or the other require different skill inventories. And who are the harbingers of these skills? They are the researchers. Research which you can use. So you require technology to convert raw material into industrial products. You require networks to convert those into information, knowledge, like that. So as India moves towards the knowledge society, more and more focus has to be on the research institutions. Because technology is changing rapidly. So who will imbibe that technology? Your research institutions. So research institutions have to change their mindset from not being purely research institutions into research predominant institutions. I'm not saying research also university. No, research predominant. Okay, just give me a minute. So for last 20, 25 minutes, I've been talking on importance of research in institutions. And now comes the dichotomy. Constraints in research. Most important constraint is financial constraint. Government says I will spend 1% of my GDP only on research. But you have, at this moment, 900 plus universities, out of which around 650 plus are in public sector. So this reduction is there in the public higher education financing, both at the central and at the state level. Amount may increase, but distribution per institution may remain same, and in real terms, because if you take care of the inflation, which is currently around 6 to 7%, there is a net decline in your funding for research. And rightly so. I'm not even for a moment discounting the availability of funds. You need funds for, at this moment, predominantly into health, into sanitation, into primary education, into pension funds, into subsidies, and rightly so, because ultimately you need to have a bottom of the pyramid large, right, and bring those bottom at the pyramid into upper levels, and only then they will be in a position to come to the higher education and that stuff. And this thing is compounded with the problem that because of the student unrest and because of the poor bank loan system, which we are improving, but still it is, I don't think even 1 or 2% of the students take loans. Either it because of the conservative attitude of the banks or because of the mindset of the students. Tuition fees are also increasing at 3 to 4% across the board. So that means institutions need funds from some other sources than the government grants. And that is, to me, the rationale of my scouting for research funding. This is the scenario which we all have been born and brought up. Three different compartments, all working independently. University focuses more on research publications. To some extent, maybe research patents. Then we have exclusive research labs like CSIRs and DRDOs and DST labs, which are classically into only research. And then there is an industry which says that give me an solution in the evening, because they are short of time, they are short of energy. They say, you prepare the chapati for me and I will eat it. So all of them produce their traditional output in exclusive compartments. And all three of them draw from the society. So I propose that something like this can be worked out. Cannot we have a UIL? University combines with industry, industry combines with lab, and we come out with a triad, three units. There are some success stories, as I mentioned, that will be my focus. There is a telecom giant by the name of Cisco. They have tied up with PEC, Punjab Engineering College. Chandigarh is a smart city, so they tied up with PEC. They created a 400 computer lab in PEC. 9 to 5 students work, study, do research. At 5 o'clock, the executives of Cisco come, start using those terminals. Win-win situation for both. These very M.Tech students are given part-time internships. I just Googled these things from best practices of NAC, and I was astounded to know one of the best colleges we have in Karnataka is RV College of Engineering. Sorry if I'm naming some colleges, because this is what is there in the NAC. Not these are not my findings, but I salute these colleges. RV College of Engineering tied up with Mercedes-Benz and created an automobile assembly simulation lab in RV College. So the latest motors, the latest engines, the latest products they have, they will get it independently tested at RV College. Wonderful. University College of Engineering, Pune. Independently handling these SPIC projects. Society for Promotion of Information and Communication. These institutions are the think tank for the government. The higher authorities in the Niti Aayog and in the ministry, they all look forward to. So please, there is a whole lot of world beyond IITs and NITs. This by no means says that IITs and IITs, they are the class apart. Fine. But please remember, there is large potential available in institutions which are not in the IITs, but neither are in the lowest bottom. So you have a huge middle channel. It is, this model is meant for them. So you will have a joint research undertaken. You will have joint research, hiring of those employees, as I mentioned in Cisco. There may be exchange of ideas, exchange of material, labs. We have an agriculture university, which was instrumental in giving green revolution to India, Punjab Agriculture University. It realized that one of the greatest curse we have is burning the stubble burning, which creates a lot of pollution, especially in the north. I saw some north participants are also there. What did it do? It tied up with the fly ash manufacturing company, a cement manufacturing company, and converted this stubble into fly ash, which are being used to prepare bricks. From where this idea has come? This idea has come from a lab in PAU. And who is using it? The cement manufacturer. So you understand, this particular model, see, please remember, this laboratory, what is it? It draws upon from the university, the researchers, and gives the products to the industry. So why not we all three join together and create it? And this can be a very, very loose relationship. Need not be through MOUs and all that stuff, paperwork. No. So you need to reconstruct your research. You need to be proactive in interaction with the industry. Stimulate their, see, each one of us are independent. I'm not losing my independence. I'm not losing my creativity. I'm not losing my entrepreneurial skill. But we all are joining together to create that. Okay. Okay, give me a moment. So how do we restructure ourselves? How do we restructure ourselves? First, move away from watertight compartments, isolated towers, into a collaborative venture. Change of the mindset. We have to be market responsive. I know many of us who are from the social sciences may take offense to the use of the word market response. Market response does not mean only the capitalist model. Even a socialist model can be. Yes, yes, please. Please feel free to. Yes, any questions you have? Yes, please. Any participant will like to? Yes.
No, sir. I think it's disturbances.
Okay, I think. Somebody, my request is, if there is a question, then you please unmute, otherwise. Okay, fine. Okay, so second is you need to change the user of the information. So your presentation has to be as per the needs of the user. I can also dabble into extremely complex equations and use parametric and non-parametric and all that stuff and come out with tables, beautiful graphs, and hello. 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 My friends, please mute in case. Okay, we need to move away from. Hello.
Sir, wait a minute.
Madam, I think. Okay, fine.
Yes, sir. Continue.
Okay, so we need to move away from this present cluster into a bigger platform. Okay, fine. So I'll leave some of the points which we can discuss later in case there is any question. I will like to specially focus on the concept of benchmarking. Those of us in management will know, but others may. Right? Benchmarking is when you try to learn from some of the best experiences and try to use that in your own field. So we need to imbibe lessons from best practices. So it could be some other institutional or could even be from different agencies or different organizations. So we need to take benchmarking as one of the modes of, right? Now this, I will like to bring to your attention. This is the typical education scenario. If you start looking at from 1980s in India, from 1980s to 90s, we had traditional research programs, right? MPhil was considered to be one of the most sought after courses. PhD was very rare. So most of us, those who joined teaching in 1980s and 90s, pursued PhD post joining. 1990 onwards, some of the private institutions, they emerged, right? So you had institutions which were created for research, institutions which were created as deemed universities like Thapar's and, right? So they were more into, right, research for their own masters or for their own organizations. Around 2010 onwards came the concept of PPP model, public-private partnership model, right? Where projects started being given to the public institutions by private organizations, right? Something like L&T is an expert in it, right? When L&T is looking after the Smart World Corporation, SWC, where they have roped in almost 10 to 15 countries in the world where they are trying to replicate the smart city model, which they are doing it in India into Africa and other parts of Asia. So public-private partnership emerged in research. And now is the trend towards the global education networks. Multilateral funded projects overseas. I'll give you an example. I'll give you an idea. Think for a moment that somebody in America has got a project on third world countries, has got a project on health and nutrition in the developing world. Where is he based? He is based in US. Do you think he'll come and put himself here for 5 years? No. He will try to find out an co-investigator. Somebody who can help him in collection of data. And who can he be? He can be you, provided you have done some research. So what will he do? He'll Google, find out health and nutrition research, comma, India. So he'll give out with 10, 15 names. If you have done research, he will contact you. That is one way. Second way, you start searching the websites of multilateral funded projects. Go to the website of United Nations. Go to the website of World Bank. Go to the website of World Economic Forum. They would have sanctioned projects running into 30, 40 million. And you find out that there is somebody who is undertaking or is planning to undertake a project in India, planning to undertake a project in Northeast. Just approach him with your resume. Just approach him with your brief idea. There is every likelihood that he will be more than keen to join you. You understand how things work out, right? So it's not that you only look at the classical agencies like ICSSR or AICT or that stuff to pick up for research. You can even scout for yourself. This is what will ultimately lead to a strong tie-up. They don't know you. You have not talked to them. You have not met them. So how will we know each other? We will only know each other through our transparency. If we are opaque, if we are not sharing the information properly, there is every likelihood that this particular relationship will fizzle out. There are certain etiquettes which are uniformly acceptable, certain norms, certain value systems. And if we have this tie, transparency, institutional values, and ethics, there is every likelihood that we'll be able to succeed in our developing a collaborative venture. Because time is short, so I will not. Right. Now, coming to my D part, that is on what are the various sources from where I can find out liberal grants for my research. But before I take that, I will like to classify what are the broad areas where which research is given. So friends, you could take it either in the form of a research grant, which could be major, minor, public, private, 2F and 12B institutions and non-2F and 12B institutions, all that stuff. It could even be for seminars, participation in a seminar, organizing a seminar. There may even be grants available for registration for a seminar, for publication of your research work, for travel, for data collection, for paper presentation. Fortunately, Atal projects do not ask for any participation fee, but otherwise, if there are some faculty development programs, some refresher courses or orientation courses, you can even seek grants for attending those projects. Okay, so these are the broad areas where the funds are available. If there are any questions, you can stop me. Otherwise, I will presume there are no questions. Okay, so typically, these are the 3+1. Why I'm saying 3+1 is these are the three institutions which give liberal grants. First is the University Grants Commission. Some states have HERA also, Higher Education Regulatory Agency, which ensures that your projects are through as per the UGC guidelines or not, but that I do not know how many states have that. Second is the ICSSR, Indian Council Social Science Research, which also gives a lot of grants, and currently their website is open. A lot of projects they are seeking help in terms of doctoral fellowships, postdoctoral fellowships, research projects, minor, major research programs, inter-institutional projects, projects of national importance, and so on, so on, large number of projects. And then there are AICT institutions which can apply for various types of grants from All India Council Technical Education. And then from 2017 onwards, another wonderful source is the National Mission on Teacher and on Training and Teachers. Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, National Mission on Training and Teachers. This provides avenues for undertaking training for improving your skill sets. Okay. Now coming to what are the major grants from the University Grants Commission. Okay. This is by no means exhaustive, right? So, some of the grants are currently not operative, but most of them are. Right? Major research projects, requirement is that a person must be a PhD. In case he or she is not PhD, then he has an option. He can associate somebody who is not a PhD as a co-investigator. Okay, so anyway, those are currently the scheme is not open, but is likely to open soon. So that you can look at if you are a PhD and at a regular faculty. Then there are minor research projects, which basically are meant to help you hone your research skills, help you prepare a research proposal, which later on will lead to a major research problem. You understand? These are stepping ladders, right? Which helps you to ultimately realize your dream of getting a major research problem. If any of your student is pursuing doctorate under you or is not getting any research grant, then you need to request him to apply for a doctoral fellowship, which I think is open all times. Okay, so doctoral fellowships are also a wonderful opportunity. Right? There is a postdoc fellowship also. In fact, there are three types of postdoc fellowships. One is a UGC postdoctoral fellowship, which is open. Suppose I want to spend a semester learning Assamese, right? Or something I want to do a research on the local culture of, right? So what I do, I try to get an academic staff fellowship for a semester, extendable by 3 more semesters. So up to maximum of 2 years, I can plan to get an academic staff fellowship. Okay. I will get all those facilities which are available to teacher researcher in the host institution of the similar level. Suppose I am assistant. So whatever is the assistant's privileges in that university, I will be entitled. Okay. So UGC ensures that. So you can apply for academic staff fellowship to UGC. Right. Then there are research awards. In case, and I presume most of us are below the age of 40 males and 45 females, we can apply for a research award. What is this research award? It's a wonderful opportunity for mid-career growth. Research award requires, yes. Vishal, you want to ask something? Please unmute yourself, you can ask. You have raised your hand now, Vishal, hello. Shall, are you there? My request is Deep Jyoti, they can unmute themselves now. Yes Vishal, you can. Yes, you can ask me a question. Yes.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Myself, Vishal Bhattwari. Sir, I just posted a question in the chat box itself. Since I was
my dear, actually, I'm looking at 3-4 things together. So maybe I would have skipped it. If you can read your question, that will be ideal.
Yes, sir. Sir, during this pandemic, can we just participate in any research projects in an online mode? Like, is there any available opportunity which you are currently aware of? Like during this pandemic, basically everything is in online mode where there is no opportunity for physical interaction. So is there any like opportunity where we can like participate or get indulged in any research project funded, like sponsored by this above, like this above platforms, which you have just suggested just now? Maybe UGC or.
Yeah. See, if you can hold on to your this thing, I will specifically mention the online platform. Okay. Currently, 28th, I know it's very short time. 28th is the last date for ICSSR postdoc fellowships. In case you are serving and you are a PhD and you intend to pursue research for 2 years as a postdoc, UGC.
Let me introduce myself. Sir, actually, I'm a PhD research scholar. So which will be fit for me, sir, basically? I'm just pursuing PhD.
You're pursuing. Are you getting any stipend?
No, sir. Basically, I have just cleared my NET and I'm just a faculty in the department. So I have no like sponsorship or fellowship.
If you are a faculty, you are covered under a different scheme. But if you are a research scholars minus scholarship, then there are different schemes. You cannot merge.
So I have no scholarship.
And you are not a faculty.
Like, I am both, sir. I'm actually a PhD scholar and as well as a faculty, both.
No, full-time faculty, but that means regular faculty.
No, not regular faculty, part-time.
So that means you are not a faculty. As per the definition of a faculty, faculty is somebody who's on regular payrolls.
Yes, right? Sir.
So you may be an adjunct or a guest faculty, right? Or a contractor.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So you are not classified under that. So that means the fellowship available to you is National Doctoral Fellowship that I think you should apply. I think last date for it is 6th of September for ICSSR. And similarly, the UGC scheme is open all 12 months. So you need to apply. Three documents are required. One, your letter of registration. Second, a consent letter from your guide. And third, NOC from your head of the institution. So head of the institution could be your head of the department or from registrar, whichever is your sanctioning authority. So with these three documents, you scan it and submit it to all these agencies. Hopefully you should get good response. Okay. So that's okay, all. Sir. Everything is in online mode. And you can continue with your current research proposal. They do not ask you to prepare another research proposal. Your existing research topic will continue, provided you are not getting any stipend. Right. Okay. The moment you get a stipend, you can continue to teach, but you will not get any honorarium from your college. You understand? You can draw salary only from one account. And for next 2 to 3 years, for your National Doctoral Fellowship, you will get a fellowship and not salary. But you will continue to teach in case you want 4 to 8 hours a week. Okay?
I hope I want.
Yes, Arun, you have
yes, sir. Questions. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yeah. Yes,
Sir, it's Arunjit from Delhi University. And my background is marine biology. So I have a query regarding the fellowship just now you have mentioned regarding academic staff fellowship. Means, is there any possibility, for example, if I want to work for at least for 1 or 2 years in marine coastal area, for example, CSIR have their research institute.
I know in Goa, they have a wonderful this thing. Yes.
Yeah. So my domain is under the means Delhi University. Can we approach them? Means, is there any rules and regulations for that?
Arunji, there is one teacher in Delhi University. I can name it also. It's a public platform. Professor Madan Lal. You Google it, you will find it. He's in SRCC. Okay.
Okay, sir.
He also used the same fellowship, right? Was serving at Punjab University. Banaras Hindu University and applied for academic staff fellowship at Delhi University. Worked there for 2 years. In the meanwhile, there was one vacancy at SRCC. He applied there as a faculty and he got selected. So it's a wonderful opportunity, right? What is the logic of this academic staff fellowship? Good that you asked me a question because there may be many faculty members who may be keen on. See, purpose is twofold. One, there are certain institutions of excellence which we have created over the last few years. Those who excel in a particular domain, for example, TIFR excels in the domain of fundamental research.
Okay,
am I right?
Yes, sir.
BARC is into the nuclear medicine.
Yes, sir.
Excellent. I am working in Punjab University and I have interest in cyclotron. But we do not have a cyclotron. But we do. I apply to BARC and request them to kindly grant me space for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. They said, okay, no problems. Provided you have a fellowship. I approach UGC under academic staff fellowship and tell them that I want to do this. They have no objection to my being there. Kindly grant me fellowship. They will ask you 2 things. Send us your NOC from your present institution and your last paid drawn slip. You will be on duty leave for 2 years in the host institution. Continue working there After 2 years, you will come back. All your perks, benefits will continue to accrue here. Your increments will be given. Your promotions will be on due date. Everything will be given. This is one benefit. Growth of institution, growth of an individual who will contribute for next 30, 40 years. Second, when my friend goes and does research at Bark, is it only research? No. He also understands the rules, regulations, the environment, conducive support system which helps to promote research. What will he do? After 2 years, he will come back and imbibe the same things in his new institution. Are we not moving away from the scenario of sons of the soil, born and brought up and worked in a particular institution and retired from same institution? It's a wonderful scheme. We must applaud the ministry there on coming out with such wonderful schemes. Why only that? I have got certain specialization. Maybe for first 10-15 minutes you must have thought I'm going astray. Now you realize how I built up the rationale for, because I'm basically I strategy person of strategy. So how I built up the rationale, and now see, I'm very sure for next one and a half hours there'll be flooding of questions. Why? Because I have aroused that particular hidden talent which you had, that latent need. So my friend, marine biology, wonderful area, wonderful institutions. Delhi University may be doing very well, but still there are institutions which are doing better than you. You, by all means, go and do it. All my best wishes. Yes, I think there is one question from Pragnita. Yes, yes.
Sir, I'm Pragnita Das, from research scholar from Department of Business Administration, Assam University. Sir, I just want to know that I'm covered under UGC-sponsored non-net fellowship. So can I switch to any other fellowship, any other options like available?
You can theoretically, but my advice is no. I'll tell you.
Okay.
Institutions normally do not give second fellowship to the same person.
Okay, so if I stop my current fellowship.
Wait, listen. Currently, suppose you are getting 18,000. I'm hypothetically saying.
Okay, sir.
You want to switch from, say, UGC to ICSSR, which is currently hypothetically giving 25. Hmm. So you are shifting because there is an increase in your fellowship. Am I right?
Yeah, sir.
Hypothetically, right? Yes. You know what happens? In the record books of UGC, you have availed one fellowship. In the record books of ICSR, you have a Wild One fellowship.
Mm-hmm.
Next time you apply for a postdoc fellowship. I hope I've answered you. You understand?
Okay.
So it is always better to complete, because at your age, I don't think you should be that much keen on the monetary incentives which are available with a fellowship. Okay. You should be more focused on completing your research. Yes. Yes. I will advise you. You start taking advantage of other schemes of other institutions. You are getting UGC fellowship, continue with it.
Okay.
Apply to ICSSR for dissertation publication award. Apply to ICSSR for best research paper award. You understand?
Okay, sir.
Apply to AICT for travel grant.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
You try to prepare a khichdi.
You try to prepare a mix of the things.
Yes, sir. Understood.
Because changing 5,000, 10,000 in a fellowship over 2 years will be only how much? 2 lakhs. I will not advise. Yes, Dhurba, you have a question, please.
Thank you, sir.
I hope others are also equally keen on my interaction. Otherwise, I will go back to my basic presentation. If others feel that I'm only one-to-one talking on one-to-one basis. No, but if these questions have relevance to all of us, we will continue. Otherwise, I can leave my email for individual questions also in case there are. So whichever way my organizers want me to be there, I'm at their disposal. Yes,
hello, sir. Hello, sir. My name is Niranjana and I'm from Kerala.
Okay.
Can I talk?
Yeah. Please. Yes.
Okay. I'm a research scholar and I'm doing my research in health economics. And I would like to know in health economics.
Okay. Wonderful. Yes.
I would like to know whether I'll be getting any fellowship from UGC because I'm not a working person. So I would like to know about it.
No. If you are registered for PhD in a 2F and 12B institution, you are entitled for the PhD doctoral fellowship. PhD doctoral fellowship is available to anybody who is enrolled for PhD in a recognized institution. That is the only requirement. It has nothing to do with the research scholars topic. Topic could be anything. Your guide and your institution must be recognized.
Okay, sir.
I hope I'm okay.
In that case, I have read about Maulana Azad's fellowship. But earlier, it used to be given on an application basis. I think now they are selecting it from the net results. Yes. So what if I have cleared NET earlier? Will I be able to apply for that?
NET validity is lifelong. UGC NET validity is lifelong. But JRF validity, I think, is only 5 years.
Okay, sir. Yes,
you are eligible. Not only that, you are also eligible for Indira Priyadarshini postgraduate fellowship.
Sir, but what I was informed that this specific fellowship, there is Maulana Azad fellowship, now they are taking it from the NET qualified list. But now, can I apply? That's my question.
See, if you are NET, that means you are NET qualified. NET has no longevity. There's no periodicity in the UGC NET. I think you are misinformed. You please check again.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
You are eligible. According to me, you are eligible.
Thank you, sir.
Any other?
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, this is Rohit, research scholar from LBU Punjab, sir.
From?
LBU, Lovely Professional University, Punjab, sir.
Okay.
And I am doing research in cooperative banking, sir. So, can I apply for doctoral fellowship to UGC at any time, or there is some specific timing, sir, for the application?
I should not ask you individual questions, but there are 2-3 things. What are the requirements? Institution must be UGC recognized. And second, the candidate must be enrolled for PhD. Okay? So according to me, you fulfill both those conditions. Okay. The third condition is for how long? You can get a doctoral fellowship for a maximum period of 3 years. Okay, extendable by 1 year in extreme cases. Okay, so that means if you are already registered for PhD, say 4 years back, 3 years back, the length of period for which you will get fellowship will only be 1.5 or 2 years. Because I presume that you will be able to do PhD within 5 years, and rightly so. Okay, and you have already done for three and a half years. Right. By the time you apply for fellowship, it will take another 3-4 months. So I will advise you to complete your PhD as soon as possible and apply for a postdoc if you are at a very advanced stage of your doctorate research.
Sir, okay. You started just 6 months back.
Okay, then you should apply. I told you three years plus 4 years, you will get it.
Oh, okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Maximum period will be 5 years from date of enrollment.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes,
sir, I'd like to interrupt, sorry, sir.
Yes, please,
you can
ask.
Can you take the questions in the last 15 to 20 minutes? If possible.
Yes. Please, you can ask.
I am Millington from University of Hyderabad. I am a research scholar. I am working migration of labor migration actually. I am looking postdoctorate award. Any fellowship in postdoc in about some North in America, US, European country.
See, see, there are large number of fellowships which are available for pursuing postdoctorate in the Western countries. Okay.
Actually, especially migration, labor migration. What? Actually, labor migration.
See, individual topics I will not be able to because if I'm not master of all the things. I can only tell you whatever are the fellowships available for pursuing postdoctorate abroad. Okay, both from Indian agencies as well as foreign agencies. Okay, I will devote 10 minutes to this. Relax, because individually I can't. Scheme it will be difficult for me to remember. But once I come out with that PPT, I will show it. Yes, any other questions?
Yes, sir. Sir, I am Durva from Assam University, Business Management Department. Sir, I want to ask, like, what if we like to join for the international or like global researchers, that research thing, just like example, there's carbon footprints or whatever environmental or like some globally research which can't be done by one country or something like that. What is the procedure or what are the things that we need to keep in mind before like going to all the those resources and all those things? Thank you, sir.
There are two ways of looking at things, two ways of doing it. And I will like to do the classical way, right? The way we have been doing it. Make it a habit to look at the websites of some of the best funding agencies. And I will name you at least five. These five you must visit regularly. When I say regularly, I mean every week. One is World Economic Forum. Second is UNDP. Third is UNESCO. Fourth is Asian Development Bank or World Bank, whichever way you want to look at it. And fifth one will be UNICEF. You understand? These are some of the most liberal funding agencies for international. Just Google one word, MFPO, Multilateral Funded Projects Overseas. You will get whole list of these projects. Now, question is not difficult to get all these lists. Difficulty is in finding out the research project where you can fit in. For example, I am doing a project on the export potential of rice from India. So, what should I look at? I should look at FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization. I should look at Ministry of Food Processing. I should look at Ministry of Agriculture. Visit their website and you will find some project being undertaken there. In that project, in the end, a word will be the end, their principal investigator, coordinator. Just send your resume, your outline, how you can contribute in that global multilateral funded project. You say, I want to study the rice growth pattern in Assam. I'm just taking a hypothetical example. Don't take it as if I'm right. So the principal investigator likes your idea, gives you a brief of what he is doing. See if there is an opportunity to collaborate, fine. If there's no opportunity, say thanks. Let's find some other opportunity, some other time. This is one way of looking at the things. Second is there are large number of education attaches with Indian embassies abroad. For example, we have a very, very powerful and a wonderful support system in Japan. Do you know there is a ministry by the name of MITI, Ministry of Information Technology and Industry in Japan? What does it do? It scouts for research opportunities. Just Google one word. Whatever I'm saying, I hope you are right. JSPS is looking for research collaborations in 11 different domains. And last date for it is 14th of September. Try to do it. I hope I have answered you, young man.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, one more question we can take. Yes, Vicky, or who is it?
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Actually, can we just take the question answer in the last 15 minutes?
Whichever way, for me, everything is fine. Okay. Whichever your friends raised in hand, not me. See, I can stretch this session for 10 hours. I can stretch this session for 3 days. It's okay for me.
It's a wonderful session. Humble request, sir, please, if possible. Right, okay. Thank you so much, sir. Please go ahead, sir.
Okay. Because I have no structured presentation, young man. Am I audible now? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Oh, sorry for the slight inconvenience. There was some power disruption here all of a sudden. There is one scheme available also for the college teachers. So that means they can avail in case they want to attend some seminar or workshop or training program anywhere. They can just ask for the grants from the UGC. Okay. And then there are, as I mentioned, there are certain specific projects for specific themes. And I will especially like to draw attention towards the capacity building programs for women managers, right? Government realized that very few of the higher academic positions like heads of the department or the vice chancellor or head of the research institutions are ladies. So government has come out with a wonderful scheme of capacity building for women managers. Incidentally, there is also a very good scheme, LEAP, L-E-A-P, Leadership in Educational Administration Program, LEAP, that is available to those of us who are professors, but I don't know whether how many of will be eligible at this moment, but in later on, you can always think of it. It's a wonderful institution. Okay. Now coming to, since I have some more schemes to cover, there is a wonderful scheme of ICSR, right? Indian Council Social Science Research. There is a list of subjects which are covered under ICSSR. You can just see that list. In case your subject falls in that category, then ICSSR is a very, very liberal funding agency. In fact, this agency has been predominantly created for research purposes. Okay. So here also there is a doctoral fellowship for those of us who do not have fellowship. So in case you are UGC NET, you can apply to UGC for doctoral fellowship, and you can also apply to ICSSR, okay, whichever you're lucky at. Okay. There is also a postdoc fellowship to those of us who are PhDs and we want to continue with our research. It could be in a similar area or some other area. Existing faculty member can also avail postdoc fellowship. They have been given the benefit of protection of their salary. In case you are getting, say, 55,000, you will continue to get the same amount, right, during the 2 years of fellowship. Okay, so protection of salary is also permitted in the postdoc fellowship for ICSSR. Once you complete your PhD, you feel that you have done some good work, you can apply for a major or a minor research project. I will always advise you to start with a minor research project because minor research project, the difference between minor and major research project is, in case of a minor research project, you do not get a research scholar. you have to you do the research yourself. In case of a major research project, there is a provision for one or two research scholars also. So in case somebody is doing PhD under your guidance, you can adjust him or her in this major research project. Okay. So duration of a minor research project typically is 18 to 24 months, and a major research project duration is normally 2 to 3 years. Okay. Then there are research programs. What are research programs? Research programs are those which are for a very specific focused research, where 2 to 3 people join together, maybe from same institution, maybe from same university, or maybe from different universities. Okay. And an extreme form of research program is what we call it as project of national importance. Okay. Project of national importance. And still better scheme is IMPRESS, IMPRESS, IMPRESS. Impactful research. IMP stands for impactful. Impactful research. Something which is tailored research, something which will be operative at micro level also, which can make all the difference at the micro level. Okay. So those are known as IMPRESS research, right? So different levels, minor research project done individually by your faculty, major research project done by your faculty along with the research scholars, project of national importance, where 3-4 institutions join together in the form of a research program, or project of national importance, and the ultimate form, IMPRESS, where project may be across the states, whole of the nation. Okay. It can even be a multinational project. Like some people have got an IMPRESS project on pharmaceutical exports. So those things are there. Okay. So this is an hierarchy of projects which are available under ICSR. Okay. And currently almost all schemes are available. Most of them have a deadline of around 10th of September. So you, after this workshop, you can Google it and see for yourself. Okay. And then there are, suppose I'm into research and I do not need a major research project. I just need 75,000 or 1 lakh or 1.5 lakhs for only data collection. Or I need it only for data compilation. Or I need it only for publication of my research findings in the form of a monograph, in the form of a book, in the form of a dissertation abstract, whatever, whichever, right? Then you do one thing. Please apply to ICSR for the research survey grant. Up to 1.5 lakh, you can claim for your research surveys. Heading of that scheme is research survey and publication grant. Okay. So you can avail this for any one or more of these activities which I have enumerated, which I have listed. Okay. So that will be up to 1.5 lakhs. Okay. Normally they give 75,000-80,000 rupees. Normally they give to any good work. What you need to submit, you need to submit a copy of your report, soft copy, along with an abstract, executive summary of your research work, or the journey plan, or what is known as the survey, outline of the survey, your research objectives, your title, your research objectives, your research plan, and your research survey requirements. Okay. So this is how you have to submit. And I think it is available almost 3-4 times in a year. So you can, if you miss out this time, you can apply. I think in December again, they invite applications. Okay. And then there is the dissertation publication. In case your work is wonderful, you have got thesis awarded, maybe a MPhil or a PhD. See, that is why the word is dissertation. It is not PhD research, okay? So it could even be a monograph, you could write. So you want it to be published, okay? So there are liberal publication grants available from ICSR for propagation of your research. The only thing is that it will be you and ICSR which will have a copyright, okay? So copyright gets transferred to ICSR, but it, in a way it's good also because ICSR has around 1100 libraries. So your book or monograph goes to all those institutions. Okay. Any questions you have on this? Otherwise I can. Okay. So we move to the AICT. AICT also, yes. AICT also has lot many schemes. I will be more focused on three, because you are most of you are youngsters, so I will be focusing more on the innovations in curriculum design. A good scheme, young faculty like say Vicky or Dev Jyoti want to start a new course, want to start a new elective, want to offer a new group of subjects. Let them apply for innovations in curriculum design. So ranging around 3.5 to 7.5 lakhs, they will get the money. What for this money is given? It's a wonderful scheme. Money is given to visit other institutions, see their infrastructure, so as to help them to develop this course and infrastructure in their own college. You understand? Special science may require some special equipments. Unless you go and see their working, you will not like to buy them. You will not like to put them in your syllabus. So, second, inviting experts from industry to come and sit and design the syllabus. Again, the focus of new education policy on employment, right? So you need your courses which are tailored as per industry requirements. How you do it? You invite them and make them interact. Am I clear? And then there is the scheme of MODROPS, where up to 20 lakhs is given for renovation of your lab, for purchase of new equipments. I have a computer system which is 10 years old. I have an LCMS which is 7-8 years old. Higher, more advanced versions have come. LCMS is an important component of my lab. A lot of data is analyzed on this. Right? What I do? I seek its replacement. So how much money you will get? You will get the money of the whatever is the price of that equipment minus salvage value of your old equipment. Suppose old equipment is 3 lakhs, new equipment is 10 lakhs. So you will get grant up to 7 lakhs. Am I clear? So that is the scheme of MODROPS. Modernization of your obsolete equipment. Very good scheme. Nationally coordinated projects. Some of you wanted to know, how can I join other projects? How can I be co-investigator? How can I be field investigator in a project? These are nationally coordinated projects where 7, 10, 15, sometimes even 20 institutions join together and apply for a nationally coordinated projects. A very good example is CERN in Germany. Those of you who are in physics will know. CERN in Germany is a project where more than 20 faculty of Punjab universities also contribute. And there are close to 3,000 plus faculty members who are coordinating in this global project. So these are what is. Okay. So National Doctoral Fellowship Program is same to that of UGC and ICSR. Only thing is that it diversifies into technical education. So those of us who are doing PhD in management or pharmacy or engineering or architecture, we have another window open, that is AICT. Okay. Same way travel grant or seminar grant. In fact, I'm very sure that Deep Jyoti must have got this grant of Atal Tinkering or Atal Lab also, because this is an AICT sponsored workshop you are attending. Okay. Any questions you have on this? Because see, if I continue reading all these schemes, it may not be very useful, but in case there are any questions, you can stop me on there itself. Similarly, there are DST schemes, large number of DST schemes. I was just going, a rough estimate is that there are more than 1,000 schemes to promote research in India. And there are 65 research agencies which give them those grants, right? So we are not starved out of funds, we are starved out of ideas, right? You do not pitch your project properly. That is the only way you will fail to get a project. Otherwise, if you pick up your project properly and the funding agency's objectives are also matching with it, you will most probably you should be able to get. Okay, then there are certain CSIR in case there are some science and engineering researchers. These are some of the schemes which you should look at. And I will be sharing my presentation with Deep Jyoti. If you just look at it, if you are able to see this, my PPT, when I'm clicking on the grant for holding symposia or Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award, you will see the hyperlink also in white. So you can just click it on it and it will take you to their website. I've done a lot of research on this, a lot of efforts I've made to prepare this presentations. So, and I frequently do all these because my purpose is somehow request my younger faculty to start entering into research in a big way. Research can be very lucrative academically as well as monetarily. Okay, so these are some of the schemes of CSIR. Then there were some questions on the international projects. I would like to focus more on international projects because this is the area where we hardly apply. Some of these schemes are fairly well known, like Commonwealth Fellowship or Indo-Canadian Shastri Initiative. The name of the fellowship is Indo-Canadian Shastri Initiative. Individual fellowship is ICSF. This ICSF fellowship comes under three domains, three different categories of Indo-Canadian Shastri Initiatives. One is a short-term project. For example, I want to do a research for 1 year on Indo-Canadian trade relations. Hypothetically, I'm saying. Could be any topic. So that involves traveling to Canada, meeting the industrialists there, meeting the faculty there, meeting the budding researchers. So I apply for Indo-Canadian Shastri Fellowship. I will get, if I get this fellowship, I will have two visits available. Two times I can visit. Duration you can check up, but I think it is around 14 days per visit. Second is a collaborative project under Indo-Canadian Shastri Fellowship. One faculty from India, one faculty from Canadian University can jointly submit a proposal. Okay, so you can submit this proposal to ICSI, Indo-Canadian Shastri Initiative. There's a website. You can upload it. Your project will require NOCs from your Indian and your collaborator institution. This project can be for a duration up to 3 years. But project must be of importance to both the countries. Or project which has wider ramifications for the mankind. Am I clear? So that is the third. There is a third category of projects. Short tenure projects. For example, I want to go to Canada to teach for a semester. Incidentally, Canada has a trimester system. So I want to go there for a trimester, 3 months. Apply for a Canadian fellowship. If you have an host, somebody in Canada is ready to, some university say in Vancouver or right, Manitoba is interested in your domain, in your resume, and they are keen that you come and teach there, attach that letter. There is every likelihood you will get this fellowship for a short-term tenure teaching. And during this period, you will be on academic leave from your parent institution. Okay. Then there are Rhodes Fellowships and Cambridge Fellowships. Right? Those fellowships, which are specific to only the UK or right, US. I will also request you to look at UKRI, UKIERI. Let me see, where is my chat box? United Kingdom Education Research Initiative, UKIERI, United Kingdom India Education Research Initiative. You can just Google in United Kingdom Joint Research Initiative, same thing. United Kingdom Joint Research Initiative has 7-8 countries. So just Google, just link yourself with the Indian partnership. So you will have UKRI, UKIERI, linking you to that website. Okay. These schemes are identical to that of the Indo-Canadian Shastra Initiative. There is similar scheme with India and US. That scheme is President Obama, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, Joint Research Initiative. You understand? That was signed at that time when they were the President and the Prime Minister respectively. So scheme still continues. Okay. There is also ISBRI Fellowship, very popular amongst us. Indo-Switzerland Bureau for Research Initiative, ISBRI, ISBRI, ISBRI Fellowship. Very popular among young faculty, those who can go from 3 weeks to 3 months in Switzerland and pursue their research there. A lot of us have got it. From 3 weeks to 3 months, depending on your research project. Okay. And then there are Third World Academy of Sciences fellowships, then Indo-Hungarian, Indo-Chinese, so many fellowships. Then there is some, because I heard a lot of questions from the research scholars, right? There is, Prime Minister Modi started this Prime Minister Research Fellowship. And there is a website also of this special I have. You can just Google it or hyperlink it here. Here, 100 doctoral fellowships are given every year, provided the research project has some industrial applicability. If your project has some industrial orientation, please do apply for this fellowship. This is available for 3 plus 1 year, total 4 years. And fellowship is 75,000. It's a very big amount. Okay. Some more Indian specific foreign fellowships. One is the LGT. LGT is the name of the company, right? So which offers 1,100 fellowships. But the fellowship is across the globe. It is 12 months in US on social entrepreneurship. So around 20 Indians go, 20 to 25 Indians go every year in this, on an average, I'm saying. Then there are 20 fellowships in US on India Appreciation Program. But the requirement here is that you need to have a very strong fundamentals on Indian history, Indian culture, Indian traditions, Indian constitution, Indian law, because you are going there as an ambassador of India. So a very, very detailed interview takes place. If you are good, for example, one of us got it on economics, Indian economy. So a lot of questions were there on what is a mixed economy and how India is managing the agrarian system and all that stuff. But it's very, very rewarding and useful fellowship. L'Oreal gives in biomedical science, again, very popular fellowship, focuses more on fashion and lifestyle. Okay. Then World Bank has schemes in the graduate schools, graduate fellowships, graduate research opportunities. So you, if you start Googling on this, and I will be very keen on Youth for India Fellowship. This is a fellowship available for doing research in the rural hinterland of India. So in your topic, in your research domain, data collection, rural India has to be predominant. And this fellowship is for 1 year and upper age limit is 30. If it's not been extended, I don't know. Currently it is. Okay. Then there are tropical research institutions and all that stuff. Right? We Indians also have a lot of interest in DART Fellowship, which is in Germany. these are some of the fellowships. I will try to wrap up by giving my recommendations. Okay. Because at the end of the day, as I mentioned, that you have around 1,100 plus foreign fellowships for Indians. You cannot possibly apply in all of them. So you must pick up those which are more promising and which are relatively liberal and more lucrative. Rhodes Fellowship obviously is highly competitive and you need to have an TOEFL score also and all that stuff. But still, it's rated among the best in the best. Right? And then there is a Commonwealth Fellowship. All three levels are there, from 3 weeks to 3 months to a term or and up to 3 years. Okay, so Commonwealth Fellowship is for short term, for a semester, for a year, and for 3 years. Fulbright Fellowships for faculty again is for 3 weeks to 3 months that you should aim at. But then I will also be very keen on ISBRI Fellowship. Those of you who are young faculty, please do keep this into your scheme of things. Indo-Canadian Shastri Fellowship, I already highlighted that because I thought that this is an area where many of you may be very keen on, because you may be very surprised to know 18 to 20% of Canadian population is Indian. Go to any university, you will find Indians being at very senior positions and they have a soft corner. So getting a fellowship and getting a collaborative project in a Canadian university may not be very tough. Another institution which is very keenly looking at Indian education system is New Zealand. There is a very distinctive feature of New Zealand. They have a mature population. But over 30 years, they have developed wonderful research facilities. Put these two things together. You have wonderful research opportunities. You have very senior scientists. But there is a huge gap for the mid-segment. Young scientists who are keen to work with the Nobel laureates, keen to work with the best in their field. And those best in the field like to share their findings with the youngsters. The only disadvantage New Zealand could possibly have is the climatic conditions. Some of those are very inhospitable, especially the Christchurch area where it is minus 20, minus 10. Otherwise, New Zealand is a wonderful opportunity for young researchers. And these are those fellowships which are currently open. Hennessy Fellowship for Microbiology, which is there in the Harvard Medical School. Cambridge International Fellowship for Doctoral Fellowship is currently open. I think 30th September is the last date. B4 Harvard Fellowship by Mittal Foundation from India. Mittals are incidentally into steel. So anything dealing with steel, you will have a good opportunity. National Nongdiang Technical University and National University of Singapore also offers PhD scholarships under the NGS, National Government Scheme of Singapore, right? So these are. Then third world fellowships are available in third world countries. Friends, these are from my side, the final, although it is, as I said, I can continue endlessly on this topic because this is of great interest to me. In the end, I will just summarize in 2 minutes. Deep Jyoti, just 2 more minutes. I know I'm exceeding my time limits, but just 2 more minutes. Two, three things, very important. Before you apply, you must keep in mind these things. All agencies give a lot of focus to the interdisciplinary projects because that is the trend globally. So that is right. You have a good idea and you are a faculty member, I will advise you, rather than getting your signatures on the dotted lines by your director, try to create a project evaluation committee at your level in your institution. If your project has signatures of 3-4 people from your or related institutions, that means this project has been screened at the institution level, and it has not been only forwarded. So that will make all the difference. That means you are serious about it, and your institution is serious about it. Lot of focus is on finding out the gaps in existing literature and what is your methodology. The evaluators may not be from your field, but they may certainly be from your research methodology domain. So as you have in last 5 years, you have gained a lot on research methodology, try to put everything into it, because more exhaustive the search methodology, more sincere is your effort. Any project, whether you like it or not, if it has got some practical orientation or commercial viability, certainly it will be given a lot of weightage. Because if you see the scoring sheet of these, and many of these institutions, especially the World Economic Forum, they are very keen and they are very transparent. They in the project itself, in the last page, they ask you to self-appraise. They have different headings, 7-8 headings. You put yourself out of 10, how much you give yourself a score. So that gives you a fairly good idea of where you are lacking at. And all these institutions have an PUPN system, PUPIN code system, that is project identification number. As soon as you apply to any project, be it ICSR or UGC or to any other AICT, automatically randomly generated number comes. And that number is the number for your project. So this is known as unique identity number of your project, or PIN, project identification number. Always save that number, because whenever you ask for any clarification, they will ask you to submit a project identification number. Okay, thank you friends. So before I thank all of you, I must also give my ideas that try to bring real world into the classrooms, because real world lies in the research, and also try to take your findings into the real world, because that is how the cycle will be complete. Thank you, Deep Jyoti, for giving me an opportunity. I know I was a substitute, and substitute people don't have high expectations from a substitute player.
It is, but not I hope like I did not disappoint you. You real gem in the entire FDP, sir.
Right. Okay. Thank you. God bless you. God bless. Yes, I can, in case you permit, I can take some questions in case.
Yes, sir. Time is there. 2-3 minutes time is there. You can take some questions.
Anything. I am available in case.
Sir, before yes, just please. Please answer one of my questions.
Yes, sir.
Sir, I had one query. Like you mentioned about these international projects and doing several projects outside the country with reference from some host members. Sometimes finding out the host members become very difficult.
Doctor, no. I tend to disagree. I'll tell you why. See, if your detailed resume is available on your website of your institution, not on LinkedIn. LinkedIn, you may have anything. You can write anything. You can even write your past president of right XYZ country. Right? Even if that country doesn't exist, you can write. But if your authentic website of your institution carries your detailed resume, and I'm sitting far off, different continent maybe, I'll be very keen that somebody has approached me. Let me go through him. But, and second, folly, I'll say blunder we all commit. Sorry, even many of you may have done that, is to create your email account on a public platform. No. Your biggest credentials are your official email account. I will not name, it's a public platform, so I will not name any mails. But if it is sksharma@ pu.ac.in. I hope Vicky, I'm... See, you need to, first of all, why should I answer to all spams? Unless it is coming from an authentic original source. I hope I've, right? So yes, try this. Try this out. Yes, sir. Any more?
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir. Myself, Bhimsen. I am from Punjab.
Sir, your voice is cracking, young man.
True. And I'm doing a PhD in
sir. I'm audible, sir.
Yes, yes. Now you're audible.
Sir, I'm Bhimsen from Punjab University, and I was very enlightened by knowledge that soon I will also meet you. And I'm doing PhD in economics department. So basically, I'm doing on impact of oil price fluctuation on macroeconomic variables like GDP and inflation. So earlier, I also searched for these DAD and Indo-Canadian fellowships. So somebody suggested me that you should first complete your PhD and you should apply for postdoc. Sir, is there any like collaboration in between PhDs? Like if I'm pursuing here for, I'm pursuing here from last 2 years. So is there any chance that I can collaborate with any foreign institute for rest of my PhD?
Bhimji, there will be two difficulties. First okay. of all, adding any name along with your guide may not be acceptable to your university or to your guide. Okay. Let's be very blunt, right? Preparing and submitting a proposal ab initio is different than changing the course midstream. Mm-hmm. Blunt. So I will advise you, if you are a fellowship holder, complete your PhD as soon as possible and apply for a postdoc abroad or India, wherever, right? First. Second, your topic is of great importance to not only India, but even to many of the other developing countries, which will also have the same problem.
Yes, sir.
If I were you, I will immediately submit a synopsis of my presentation, of my idea to Niti Aayog, and especially to the infrastructure development branch of Niti Aayog.
Okay, sir.
Niti Aayog has a task force on renewable energy, where the hidden agenda is how to move away from oil.
Yes.
If your project is of some interest to them, they will be approaching you, not the other way around.
Okay, sir.
You got my message?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
See, you do not require AK-47 to kill a mosquito. You just require where it is sitting.
Yes, sir.
Find out the right source. They are flush with funds. All these institutions are very, very liberal in funds. But the only problem is we do not know where to apply. And we end up applying to an institution which may not have any funds at that time. Okay. Any other
questions? Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, Chetan. Yes, anyone.
Yes, Chetan. If possible, sir, can you supply us your email ID or something that we like to know about something or something that we can call? Like.
No, I'm not getting your question.
Let me
first close my presentation. I think that will be easier then. Yes, sir.
If you can please supply us with your interview or something, we can like you or something.
Deep Jyoti, are you able to get what he is asking?
No, sir. Mr. Dhruva, can you just write it in chat box so that you can read, because your voice is breaking.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon, please.
I really want to know, your session is very good. It's so informative and thank you so much. So one question I would like to ask, being the professor in the private university, it is very difficult for us that when we are, sending the proposals. So being the private university, we are not going to get so many good projects or anything. So anything you just going to recommend us so that when we are applying for such projects or anything, how we are going to get that?
See, Dr. Chawla, I differ. I differ in the sense that we have a feeling that there is a discrimination in terms of private and public institutions.
Right.
Let me confide.
Okay.
We also evaluate. We also go. First, before you'll be very surprised. Before the detailed proposal is evaluated, a blind executive summary without the name of the institution and without the name of the guy, the candidate, is submitted to the experts.
Okay.
So there is no way Sanjeev Sharma will know whether this project has come from a private or a public institution. So remove that doubt from your mind. I'm being very authentic, very original on this. So that means if I'm not getting a project, something must be really not up to the mark,
yes,
to the expert. Am I right? So rather than blaming the system, I will like to work on how to improve that. There is a way out. That way out is show it to knowledgeable people. Right. Do not, you know, problem kaha hoti hai. Sorry, where there is a problem. Problem is that we sit with our guide, finalize everything, and submit it to the institution. Howsoever brainy you may be, please remember only two brains have put in their efforts.
Right.
Why we don't consult others? I'll tell you the reason also. Reason is that somebody will copy my idea. There may be cases, but very rare. More people who critically evaluate your project, better the end result. My request is try this.
Sure.
There's no
sure.
discrimination. To best of my knowledge, no discrimination.
Thank you.
Hello. Yes, any other questions, please?
Any other questions?
Okay, I will put in my email also. In case you have any questions, you can Google me anytime. Sorry, email me anytime. So I will try to answer as many as I can. Otherwise, I'll refer to the concerned website. Okay. Thank you, Deep Jyoti. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. Thank you. God bless you all. Thank you, sir.
I request quickly Anamika ji to give the vote of thanks to sir.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Good afternoon to our honorable resource person, Professor S.K. Sharma from Punjab University, Dr. Deepjyoti Chaudhary, the coordinator of this FTP, all the other distinguished members of the organizing committee, and all the esteemed participants of this FTP. Myself, Anamika Kerr, research scholar, Department of Education, Assam University, and teacher educator in Vivekananda College of Education, Karimganj. I consider this opportunity as a great honor to offer the vote of thanks in this last, but definitely not the least important technical session of this 5-day long FTP on research methodology organized by Department of Business Administration, Assam University, Silchar, in association with Atal Academy. I extend my heartfelt gratitude to our honorable resource person, Dr. S.K. Sharma, professor in the University Institute of Applied Management Sciences, Punjab University, for sparing his valuable time to enlighten us on the topic, opportunities, grants, job prospects, funding organizations for projects, etc. after PhD. Sir, you started your session with contextualizing the topic with the current pandemic situation very nicely. You focused on researching in VUCA world, that is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous world, the paradigm shifts in higher education. You discussed about the new institutional architecture of higher education as envisaged in NEP 2020. You explained the need to establish National Research Foundation. Also, you mentioned about the five forces model of higher education and explained the need of collaborative research. Sir, you have discussed about the technology-enabled emerging dimensions of research and the importance of developing 21st century skills. You mentioned about the paradox of our time, that is growing inequalities and knowledge divide. You discussed about the financial constraints in research and emphasized on the need of university-industry laboratory partnership and reconstructing research through collaborative approach. You mentioned the action points for successful survival and the emerging value chain in research. You have elaborately discussed about the various category of research grants and fellowship schemes offered for researchers by UGC, ICSSR, AICT, and other research funding bodies. You have also discussed about international research opportunities in detail. You have answered all our queries in an effective and elaborate manner. Sir, I thank you from the core of my heart for enlightening us by your knowledge and presence. I would also like to extend my gratitude to Dr. Dipjyoti Chaudhary, coordinator of this FDP, and all the distinguished members of the organizing committee for organizing such an enlightening FDP for all of us, and especially for giving me this opportunity to offer the vote of thanks. I would like to thank all the esteemed participants of this August FDP wholeheartedly for their active participation throughout the sessions. Last but not the least, I would like to offer my gratitude to the Almighty God for showering the blessings for making this FDP a grand success. Thank you all. Have a nice day.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, Deepji. Thank you. Thank you. God bless you all. I'll be sending my PPT to you.
Sure, okay, sir.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, friends. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.